Thank you, folks, and thanks for being here. Yeah. I'm going to try my best to entertain you all here. I just had a nice meal down the street. Not no restaurant near here, so I was lucky that Paul.
It's hard to hear you.
Okay, well, should I crank it up? How do you crank it up, Paul? We need somebody that knows how to do it. Yeah, crank it up. It's louder than we thought.
Yeah.
Anyway, yeah. I don't know, I changed my mind. Till then I was a random kind of love I can't explain, that I had for Nellie Kane. Well, she took me on to work that day to help her till the land. Everything a man could want to know, and it was then I realized that I would never go. Well, I would never go. Well, I don't know what changed my mind. Till then I was a rambling kind of love I can't explain, that I had. To him, she became my all. She became my all. Well, I don't know what changed my mind. Till then, I was a rambling kind of love I can't explain, that I had for Nellie Kane. That I had. Jumped up in the middle of the east at 5:15 this morning. The wife jumped up to feed the kid at 5:15 this morning. The sun jumped up in the middle of the east, and the wife jumped up in the middle of the bed, and I jumped up in the middle of a dream at 5:15 this morning. Well, the woman got the kid off it by 6:15 this morning. I had done made up our bed by 6:15 this morning. Well, the baby played on dancing feet, and woman stirred up a bite to eat, but that dream still pounded in my head at 6:15 this morning. Work and the sun got warm at 7:15 this morning. I have my lunch pill under my arm at 7:15 this morning. That dream kept ringing in my ear and getting plainer and coming clear and getting bigger and drawing near at 7:15 this morning. Well, I guess you know how some dreams are at 8:15 this morning. I can't remember what they are at 8:15 this morning. Well, I scratch my head at the factory gate. I run to keep from being late. And the clock said 15 after 8 at 8:15 this morning. Boss and I talked to my friends at 9:15 this morning. I was fishing around inside my brain at 9:15 this morning. Seen my dream like a haze or a snatch or a flame from some old fiery match, but the rest of the dream I could not catch at 9:15 this morning. So at 15 minutes after 10, at 10:15 this morning, I told my trouble to all my friends at 10:15 this morning. Well, I told them my dream as plain as day and how it run like a rabbit away. They said, keep trying if it takes all day at 10:15 this morning. Great to be with you today, this evening here in West Whately, Massachusetts, I'm pretty sure. It's Tuesday. Oh no, it's Wednesday. It must be Watermelon Wednesday. Yesterday was Rutabaga Tuesday. Much better to have watermelon than rutabaga. Last night I was in New York City playing on the concrete, and it was nice and everything, but it's nicer in here. I have to say. Here's a song, an old ballad from the folk music bag. A lot of these old ballads, the guy goes away and says goodbye to his sweetheart, and he comes back 7 years later and wants her to remember him. And this is one of those. The guy and the girl, they pledge their love, and he goes away, and then 7 years later, let's tune in on the what was once a young couple and see what happens now. Thank you. pocket, and on his finger he wore a golden ring. When she saw that band of shining, another song her heart did sing. And then he threw his arms all around her, kisses gave her 1, 2, 3. Said, "I'm your true loving soldier, just come back home to marry thee." Pretty fair maid, all in her garden, he came up to her again and called her, said, "Pretty fair maid, would you be my bride?"
Thank you.
Foot in front of the other, stepping into the here and now. I'm not sure just where I'm going, but I'm gonna get there anyhow. Well, I got this far with no direction. I follow my nose to where I stand. My heart's still strong and I know I'll make it. Sit right down in the promised land. Sister, come walk beside me till our pathway. Love to give you, even this hand, eye to eye. When you left me in springtime, so many questions in my mind. Summertime came to live me with, not one answer would I find. That I saw you on the Rocky Mountains, I felt you on the Great North Sea. It's a lonesome road I had to travel. You will always be with me. Brother, come and walk beside me till our pathways do divide. Nothing much but love to give you, even less have. Laughter in the thunder, and I feel comfort in the wind. I see hope and hopeless faces, and someday they will love again. People come and walk beside me till our pathways do guide. Nothing much but this love to give you, even less hell. Walk beside me till our pathways do divide. Nothing much but this love to give you, even less have I to hide. I put one foot in front of the other, stepping into the here and now. I'm not sure just where I'm going. I'm gonna get there anyhow.
Thank you, folks. Appreciate it. This song about the working man and women. Men and women. I know all you do some work, even the folks are too young to have a legal job. They do some work. Might not get paid right for it.
I'm working on the river, up and down the line. I'm working on the river, I'm working on the boat. I'm working on the log jam, and it's thinking folks. I'm working in the kitchen, the shop, and with the 9-5, and washing dishes all by my life. I'm working in the morning, in the afternoon, bringing in the harvest underneath the moon. I got two hands, a back that's strong, I put them in a rhythm, sing a working man's song. I've been working since the dawn of time, anybody working is a friend of mine. Library reading the law, working with the paper, the brushes in the pen. Finish up a job and I'm starting again. I kiss my woman goodbye. I'm leaving soon. Working at the square dance, playing the fiddle soon. I'm working on a big rig, a hands on a wheel, loading up a trailer with the 3 tons of steel. I got two hands, the back that's strong, and put them in a rhythm, sing a working man's song. I've been working since a long time. Anybody working is a friend of mine. Garden, I'm chilling in the trees, I'm holding up the road, I'm pulling up the weeds. I'm working in the schoolhouse, working on the news, I'm working in a honky-tonk, singing the blues. I'm working in a hospital, filling that form, setting broken bones, helping baby be born. I got two hands, a back that's strong, and put them in a rhythm, sing a working man's song. I've been working since the dawn of time, anybody working is a friend of mine. Beer. Got the wrinkles on my face, it's a price to pay, but just a running is a race. Saving up my wages, I put them in the bank, paying on the mortgage, I'm filling the tank. Saving up for college for a rainy day, I'm raising up a chili, keep it working away. I do what I can to keep the wolf from the door, I'm working like my father and his father before. Yeah, I got two hands, a back and strong, I put them in a rhythm, sing a working man's song. I've been working since the dawn of time, anybody working is a friend of mine.
Working is a friend of mine.
Well, I've got all these instruments up here, and I'm going to try to use them all before the night's out. The band, I'd like to introduce the band now, but they didn't come. All their stuff's here. Just play it without them, I guess. No, it's true. It's a sort of a result of corporate downsizing. A lot of tools sitting around unused. So I'll try to use it for you. Here's a little ragtime tune for you. It's called the Black and White Rag. I think it might have been for the piano. I'm not sure. You wouldn't know it's an instrumental. It doesn't say anything. Thank you. about the login game. This is written anonymously. The lyric comes from a poem from the late 1800s. The guy's working up in the Adirondack Mountains, the Sacandaga River Valley, I guess, and it all tells the story. This is a good folk song because it's got a lot of work in it. It's got danger and the love affair and a little death in there, too. I guess I have to apologize about that. But it's part of the life, they say. He's dying. Anyway, this is called My Girl's Waiting for Me. The scary instruments in all of bluegrass music. Virginia, by the way. I come from the town of Wheeling, West Virginia, up there in the northern panhandle. And I'm pretty sure a banjo player from West Virginia invented the toothbrush. I'd like to claim that. Anyone else would have called it the teeth brush. This is a song I made up myself called Red Dog in the Morning. That's very exciting. We're going to do a lot of touring on that for sure, starting in late September. But also, Hot Rise has been in the studio making a new recording, which was a really long time in coming. Of course, there's a lot more work to do on it, so it'll take a while for it to get finished. But we did record this next song. I'll try to render it for you. You Are On My Mind. Thank you. Well, let's see here. I got the fiddle now. It's fiddle time on the old stage. I like the old fiddle tunes, the old time fiddle tunes, and I know our promoter Paul does. He's a fiddler himself. We speak a certain language as fiddlers that other people don't understand. And so I like this kind of fiddle tune I'm going to play for you. This is one that's when the, you know, the guitar player says, what are the chords to this? You can just say, D. This is called the Kaw River. This is, comes from the Midwest or Oklahoma, I believe. Tommy Gerald from Mount Airy, North Carolina. Any folks been to the Mount Airy Fiddlers Convention down there at the end of May? A couple folks yet? That was Tommy's hometown. And Tommy was a guy who worked for the state road, and then when he retired, he'd been playing music all his life, playing the banjo and the fiddle and telling stories and singing songs and all that kind of stuff, but he took it on with a vengeance after he'd retired, and he sort of made it known that he was available if people wanted to come down and pick, they wanted to learn tunes and that kind of thing. Well, he was open. And as a result, his style is kind of the style that most of the young old-time music aficionados go after. I was reminded of his influence when I was with Hot Rise many years ago. We were touring in Europe, and we ended up in Sweden at the top uppermost part of our tour. I think it actually ended in Sweden. We started in France and worked our way up, and as the weeks went on, the organization of the tour went sort of worse and worse. And our road manager, by the time we had gotten to Denmark, he had neglected to book any motel or hotel accommodations. We ended up sleeping under his dining room table while he played his Frank Zappa records for us. And that was a high point of the tour. And then we went on to Stockholm when it was very late to get there. Kind of a long drive, you had to dodge the moose and all that kind of stuff. And we got all the way up there, and then we're in the old town, old part of Stockholm, the narrow streets. And, we're late, so there's a big crowd outside the club, and because we hadn't done our sound check, they wouldn't let the people in yet. So I slide the door of the van open, and a guy comes up immediately, like his face shows up immediately. He's got a leather cowboy hat on. He says, "Y'all want a chaw tobacco?" I said, "No, thanks." He said, "How about some moonshine?" I said, "Well, maybe after the show." And he said, "Are y'all going to play some G-Runs? I loves G-Runs." I said, "Don't worry, our guitar player will play some flat runs. Don't worry, you'll like that." And I said, "Where are you from?" He said, "Down south." And I said, "Where in the south?" He said, "South of Sweden." And I come to find out that he learned how to speak English at Tommy Gerald's house. So this is called a Jack of Diamonds, got a lot of names, but it goes something like this. I gambled in Spain. I'm going back to Carolina. I'm gonna play my last game. And Jack of Diamonds, Jack of Diamonds, I've known you from old. You robbed my poor pockets of silver and gold. Well, I eat when I'm hungry. I drink when I'm dry. Much better. I'm gonna sprout wings and fly. I'm gonna get down the old fiddle. I'm gonna rosin up the bull. I'm gonna make myself welcome wherever I go. Jack of Diamonds, Jack of Diamonds, I've known you from old. You robbed my poor pockets of silver and gold. And I was so dark, well, I would dive down to the bottom and I would never come up. But the river's not whiskey, look at me, I'm no duck. I'm gonna play these drunkard's hiccups and then trust to my luck.
Well, I saw
so. Said there's two hearts outside of town. It's been too long since I came around. If I get there before too late, they might not fill their hearts with hate. I'll knock on the door if they let me in. There's a real good chance that love can win. Where'd love come from? Where's love go? What feeds love and what makes it grow? And that's all we need, yeah, we need to know. Where's love come from? Where's love go? Well, now mama died 2 years ago. Children, here I go. The hardest thing in life I'll do is try to say goodbye to you. Sister was there for her last breath, and she said it was a very peaceful death. But mama's love, it is on and on. It's like some never-ending song. With love, come from? Where'd love come from? Where'd love go? What feeds love and what makes it grow? It's all we need and we need to know. Where'd love come from? Where'd love go?
Thank you very much. The great Hank Williams, by request. Some people cheat, they steal a lie for wealth and woe, it will buy. But don't they know on Judgment Day all the gold and silver melt away? What good is gold and silver too when your heart's not pure and true? Sinner, hear me when I say you better get down your knees and pray. I'd rather be in a deep dark grave than know that my poor soul was saved and living this world in a house of gold and deny my God.
Bit of churchy mood here on Wednesday.
Sister,
Let's see.
Well, I had a request, I guess. I'm going to play the song anyway, though. No, actually, Paul requested this. This is a song that was written by a fella from the Bay Area of California, San Francisco Bay Area, Butch Waller. He has a bluegrass band called High Country that's been going on for probably over 40 years now. And just a real standard bearer for the music. It's a beautiful song he wrote in the style of Bill Monroe. Walked out that beach of sand, I looked out to sea from the edge of the land. I watched the seabirds fly where the ocean rolls, and I wonder why my heart's so Reed. She was from North Carolina, grew up there, but then she moved to Delaware with her husband, Bud Reed. She was Olabel Campbell. She and her, actually her brother, Alex Campbell, they had, the three of them had a group, and they played, they had a country music park there in Delaware. She was one of the rare breed of women band leaders and country singers, so country songwriters. I once saw her do a gospel workshop at a folk festival in a little chapel at a college up in West Virginia, near where I'm from. And she was just so impressive. And I've been a big fan ever since. I was a fan already, but this is one of my favorite songs of hers, I've Endured. Take credit for anything, really. This is a banjo, of course. A lot of people make fun of the banjo. But I like the banjo. I like getting lost in it. It's like a different thing. It's like a whole different. It actually makes no sense as a musical instrument. That's what I like about it. It might not really be a musical instrument. Most of the bluegrass instruments sort of look like toys. The mandolin and the fiddle, you know, they're like toy instruments. once there was a banjo player on stage. He was just tuning up, just tuning all the time, tuning, tuning, tuning. He'd play tune for 5 minutes and then play for a couple minutes and tune another five. Finally, there was a guy who was just a little frustrated in the third row. He said, "You know, I saw Earl Scruggs last week, and he only tuned once during the whole show." And the guy stopped tuning. He looked up. He said, "Well, you know, some people just don't care." I left my banjo. Actually, I had my banjo. I had to get it repaired, and I just gotten it back from the shop. And I had to run some errands after that. I went to the post office and everything. I locked my car. You know, I was just in there a few minutes looking at my post office box. I came back out. As I got to my car, I realized that the rear window of my car was broken out. And I looked in the back seat. My worst fear confirmed: two banjos in there. Anyway, this is a song recorded with Daryl Scott. It's coming out in September. This is called "Time to Talk to Joseph." song from early days of country music, or at least the early days of recorded country music. That's an interesting border. You have the date when stuff started getting recorded. It's certainly not the oldest country music, but it's some of the earliest documentation we have about it. One of the guys I love so much was a guy named Doc Boggs, and he was from Norton, Virginia, down in the southwestern corner of the state there, and a coal mine guy, but he played the banjo, and he figured out he made more money playing music for the miners than he did actually coal mining. And he had a real raw style and sang the blues with a banjo. I'll try this country blues for you. let's see. Well, it's been quite a night already. The watermelon was excellent. I've been missing watermelon, and you know, just in time for Wednesday.
There'll be more next Wednesday.
Yeah. I'm gonna try to play another bluegrassy number. Father of bluegrass music, and of course that would make his brother Charlie the uncle of bluegrass music, I guess. Anyway, that's just a joke. This guy goes into a job interview, and he's getting interviewed, of course, and the guy he wants to get the job from is interviewing him, of course, as you would. So the guy says, what do you consider one of your worst qualities? And the guy goes, that'd probably be my honesty. And the interviewer says, well, I don't think honesty is a bad quality. He said, I don't care what you think. I asked Paul, actually, when I got here, I said, is it pronounced Whately or Whately? He said, is what pronounced Whately or Whately? Anyway, Bill Monroe is the father of bluegrass music. And he synthesized all these things. If I can only say the word synthesize, everything would be fine. He brought these things together. The old ballads from Europe, and especially the British Isles. Also, the old fiddle tunes from there. And then, of course, the African sounds of the blues and jazz he heard around his native Kentucky, as well as up in Chicago when he went away to work in the oil refineries up there. And he kind of put it all together, along with the gospel music, and became what we call bluegrass music. He named it after his home state of Kentucky, the bluegrass state. And his particular recipe for that music became known as bluegrass music. And he can't play it with just one guy, but I'm going to try to approximate some of the things that happens with the gospel quartet, where they have the sort of big harmony vocals. And also in bluegrass, they have the counterpoint between the fiddle and the voice, which is kind of like a vine going around a tree. And when you hear Bill Monroe's music the first time, you assume that he must be the fiddler, because the fiddle's so prominent in the music. Here's one called Working on a Building.
Thank you.
It's a Holy Ghost building. It's a Holy Ghost building. Hallelujah. Holy Ghost building for my Lord, for my Lord.
Sing one about my big hero, a guy named Doc Watson. And it's been well over a year since he died, but I keep singing this song because I kind of want to make sure people remember. And there's no way I can be Doc Watson, but I always wanted to be. It was always, you know, I looked up to him so much. Let me get this thing situated. I remember seeing him on TV the very first time when I was probably like 13 or 14 years old, and they brought this guy out. It was like a live, you know, it was like a tape from a folk festival on public TV, and they brought this guy out and kind of guided him out. And he's blind, of course, nearly since birth, and he was just a brilliant musician. They brought him out onto the stage and sort of set him up by these microphones, and then he just started playing and singing. And I was going, man, that is exactly the way you should play the guitar. That is the way you should sing, and I've been trying to do it ever since. But you just like Bill Monroe. You play all these divergent kinds of musics. You make it all seem like one thing. Get
down my old boat, I'd set sail if she float, 'cause I got them deep river blue. I'm going down to Muscle Shoals to dive deep, baby, there I'm told.
To know Doc a little bit anyway, as the years went by. Playing around with Hot Rise, we played on a lot of the same shows together, opening for him. Of course, everybody that was around him was his student. But he never treated you like that. He always treated you like you were just one of the fellas. In fact, even on stage, you know, he'd be on a big festival stage playing for 10,000 people or something. Felt like he was just singing for you. Felt like you were sitting next to him on a rocking chair on a porch somewhere in the mountains of North Carolina where he was from. He'd sort of charm you with his sort of honey-coated voice. He'd sing the real pretty versions of the old ballads and the blues and rockabilly and contemporary folk songs, like I say. And then he'd dazzle you with some hot guitar thing. Years went on, he sort of started to slow down a little bit. I tried to get him interested in doing some recording and stuff, and he was always kind of reluctant. He had a lot of things to do, and then of course he was slowing down after that. I sort of got the cue I should leave him alone, you know. After all, he was sort of God to me. Felt like he had done his work. Anyway, but I'd drive by. I live in Nashville and I drive a lot up and down I-81. And you're pretty close to where he's from sometimes as you drive up and down there north and south. I'd always wonder what it would be like to see Doc at his home, just to call him and see him how he's doing. So about a year and a half ago, it was in February, I was playing Boone, North Carolina, not far from where he lives. And I got the nerve up to call him. So the next morning I was supposed to head back to Nashville. There was a snowstorm coming in. And to go to see Doc, you'd have to go up into the mountains from there. And better judgment would have said, just head home and beat the storm. But I got the nerve to call him up. And like I said, I've known him for years. Still afraid to call him. So I get him on the phone, he answers the phone. I said, Doc, this is Tim O'Brien. I said, I wonder how you're doing. He said, what's your name again? I said, Tim O'Brien. He said, I don't know you. I said, that's okay. You don't need to know me. I just wanted to call you and thank you for all the good stuff you've done all these years. For showing a guy like me what you could do with music. Please try to. He said, what's your name again? I said, Tim O'Brien. He asked his daughter, who was there, Nancy. He said, his name is Tim O'Brien. She said, oh, Daddy, you know him. He said, he's that fiddle player that plays at Merle Fest. He said, oh. It was like a long pause. He said, oh, you're the fiddle player that plays at Merle Fest. Anyway, he told me all kind of good stuff. I asked him how he was doing. He said, well, he missed his wife. She'd been in the hospital for a whole year, and in fact, the last couple of months hadn't been able to talk at all. So I just hope she gets better enough so we can have a couple good more years together. He told me about recently being saved and how important that was. One thing led to another, and I was invited up. So when you drive from Boone, North Carolina, up to Deep Gap, where Doc is from, you're driving right up onto the top of the Blue Ridge there. You're going east towards the Blue Ridge. And of course, the snow started coming down as I got up higher and higher in elevation. It really came down big flakes. And when you leave Boone, you start up there. Eventually, you're on a section of Highway 421 that becomes known as the Doc and Merle Watson Highway.
Doc's house, you turn south on Doc Watson Road. They're proud of him around there. Doc's a little embarrassed about it. He was always felt like a humble guy. They made a statue of him in Boone. And they put a plaque on it that said, the great Doc Watson. And when he heard about this, he said, what? You can't put that on there. And they said, Doc, what should we put on there? And he said, well, just put Doc Watson, one of the people. Anyway, I got up the Doc Watson Road there and I finally got to his house. And I knew I was there when snow was coming down so strong. It was just so beautiful up there on the North Carolina Brewery. I turned off my car and I could hear him picking through the window of the kitchen there. I could see him through the glass door. He was singing an old folk song apropos of the day. Night, and drinking that good old wine, thinking about that dear little girl, stole this heart of mine. She is like a budded rose that blooms in the month of June. She likes a it's just been making me tune. It's just beautiful, you know. Anyway, I waited till he was finished, and then I knocked on the door there, and he said, slide it open, it's open, unlocked. I went in there, and I said, Doc, it's great to see you, it's looking well. He was sitting there playing the guitar. His daughter had gone home. It was just him. Just Doc Watson. Master and student, to me, at his feet. I said, is it all right to bring him my guitar in and we'll play up some tunes? He said, that'd be fine. What I realized later, he was just kind of waiting for somebody to show up. He wanted to play some music. He wanted to be Doc Watson. And I wanted to be a student. And I always will be, but it was great to be right at his feet there again. We played old songs like John Henry and Sugarfoot Rag and all that kind of stuff. But he was getting kind of forgetful. He would forget the words and forget how the song went. But he told me a lot of great stories about growing up there. He kept talking about this one guitar that he had. It was he said, have you seen that guitar I have? It's called a Dana Bourgeois guitar. I said, well, Doc, I don't really know. I think I might have seen a picture of it. He said, it's a dreadnought guitar with a cutaway. I said, well, I might have seen a picture of you with that. He said, that was a really good guitar, but then something happened. I said, what happened? He said, well, we had a picking party at my house one day here. I got up to get something to eat, I guess. Somebody put that guitar where it shouldn't have been. He said, I got up and I went back to my chair and I stepped right in that guitar. Broke it clean through with my foot. He said, that's terrible. He said, well, it was bad, but the maker heard about it. He said, send it back. See what I can do. He said, I believe it's better than it ever was. We play another song, and he'd talk about it again. And finally, he said, I think I'm going to go get that guitar. I want to show it to you. Of course, his hearing was failing. For a long time, he thought there was more than one of me there. He said, he kept calling me, you fellas. But after a while, he understood it was just me. Anyway, he said, like I said, he couldn't hear very good, but he got up out of his chair and reached behind him, about three steps behind him, to the door to the basement, opened that door, and he started down the stairs, and I'm going, oh my God, 89 years old and blind, he's going down the stairs there. Oh man, should I help him? But you don't ask him for help. I mean, you don't ask him to help him, because if he wants to do something on his own, he will. This is the man who's rewired his own house. Even though he's blind, he could fix air conditioners and cars. He built his own shed, and he said, the guy said, you probably bent a few nails when you built that thing. He said, no, son, I'm nearly a one. He's very proud of that. He's humble about his music, but he's proud that he was independent. So like I say, he's heading down the stairs there, and I'm like kind of freaking out. So you can sort of hear me thinking. He turned around and said, don't worry, I'll be careful. If I said, if I fall and break my neck, he said, just call the veterinarian. So he shut the door and he went down the stairs and he's gone for about 20 minutes. So I'm kind of worried about him, you know, down there. There was no crashing around or anything, no cries for help. You can better believe I was listening, though. Anyway, he comes, finally comes back up the stairs and he's opens that door. He's got a guitar case in his hand. Through, he shuts the door, takes the three steps right back to his chair, sits down, opens up that case, gets out the guitar, hits a note on it. He says, that's not the guitar I was talking about at all, is it? I said, no. He said, it's a good one, though. When the day was over, I had to head on back to Nashville. I said goodbye. He reached in his shirt pocket, and all along he'd had his $20 bill in his shirt pocket to give me for lunch. He said, Doc, I can't take your money. I made a whole living out of imitating you. You bought me so many lunches and dinners and breakfasts, it's not even funny. So I just want to say I'm glad I got over my fear of calling Doc on the phone. I'm glad I got to see him in his home environment. I'll never forget that day. Don't you see, 'cause I've got the empty river blue. Now it's time to say goodbye. If that boat sinks, just let me die, 'cause I've got the empty river blue. Let it rain, let it pour, let it rain a whole lot more.
Some real fine musicians in the crowd, and I'd like to invite them up. I'd like to invite Mr. Chris Brashear up to come and play, and also Mike Barnett, who's a real leader. He'll bring his fiddle up.
Why don't you grab the mandolin? We'll play some bluegrass music. We'll try.
Chris is a fiddling doctor from over in Amherst, and we got Mike Barnett from the fabulous Deadly Gentlemen. He's one of the Deadly Gentlemen. And we'll try to entertain you all with something we've never played together before. Have you guys even met each other? You have met each other. Chris plays with Robin and Linda Williams a good bit, and is a fine songwriter, and you'll hear he's a great instrumentalist. We're going to tune up for about 5 or 6 minutes, if that's okay. Mike and I are heading over to the Grey Fox Festival tomorrow. That's over in Oak Hill, New York, on the north side of the Catskills. And it's a great bluegrass festival I go to pretty much every year. And I'll be playing there on Saturday. If you'd like to know where I'm going to be, you can do what I do every morning just to make sure. You can log on to timobrien.net. All right, we're going to share the mics here and play a little tune called Handsome Molly. What do you say? 1, 2, 3. Seaport town, set my foot on steamboat.
sailing around the sea. They can't answer Molly wherever she might be. Church on Sunday, passing me on by. I can tell the look is changing by the movement of her eyes. Her hair is like a raven, her eyes as black as coal. Cheeks are shown like lilies out in the morning glow. While sailing around the ocean, sailing around the sea, they can answer Molly wherever she might be. Some of the people in town set my foot on the steamboat and I sail the ocean round. While sailing around the ocean, I sail around the sea. They can't smile wherever she might be.
The little Georgia Rose.
Smile and I will tell her that she was.
Some more music for you together, because it's just kind of fun. Who knows what'll happen, you know? It's a jam session. We might make a mistake or something. Go ahead and try to sue us. Tuning is never tuned to a mandolin. You don't know this is tuned to a mandolin, do you? Alright.
You guys just do this.
Two, one, two, three, yeah. Thank you. if you feel like.
Yeah.
I just like to sing this last one for you because it's important.
Made up my mind to go someplace so far away. I headed west without a said goodbye. No hugs or tears and away. It's probably for the best. Sent cars along the way. Said I was looking for a brand new life. But I never settled down. My wanderlust would always cut the ties just like a knife. Sometimes a lonesome wind, it calls out like it knows me. And on a night like this, when I don't know where to go, it shows me the way. 'Cause he knows. Takes me away. I always looked at him. I was so afraid that I'd be caught behind. Follow the crooked stream to places I had never been in one more highway sign. I'm like some other guys. I might count the hours till the day will end. But it's not so I can rest. For me it's time that's best for talking to my friend. 'Cause he knows me.
Scattered footsteps on the shifting sand. Whatever pushes me, it's something only he could ever understand. 'Cause he knows me. My brother went. He's lonely too.
Thank you very much for being here tonight, folks.